Only patients with severe and debilitating occlusive disease of the aorto-iliac segment should be considered for surgery. In general, these patients will have claudication that is progressing or disabling patients with rest pain, ulceration, or gangrene who fall in the limb salvage group may require surgery to preserve limb function. These patients are generally elderly and have associated generalized arteriosclerosis with a high incidence of coronary disease and hypertension. In addition, the majority are long-time smokers, and it is not unusual for limitation of pulmonary function to be present. The risks associated with these factors must be carefully weighed against the benefits expected from a successful surgical procedure. The careful selection of patients is of the utmost importance. A midline incision is made from the xiphoid to the pubis to afford maximum exposure. Figure 1, the abdomen is explored for the presence of other pathology, and the intra-abdominal arterial tree is carefully assessed. Figure 2 demonstrates typical aorto-iliac occlusive disease. The aorta is freed by entering the retroperitoneal space. The posterior peritoneum is divided, and the duodenum is mobilized until the renal vein is identified. Sharp and blunt dissection then is used to clear the aorta on its anterior, lateral, and medial surfaces. Figure 3. It is usually not necessary to encircle the aorta or to free it completely. This often adds to troublesome bleeding from lumbar arteries and veins. Additionally, if the left renal vein is not visualized, it may lie beneath the aorta and be injured by such a dissection. Heparin is injected intra-arterially to protect the distal extremities from thrombosis, as outlined for resection of abdominal aortic aneurysm. An aortic clamp is then used to clamp the aorta proximally just below the renal arteries. Figure 4. A second aortic clamp is placed horizontally to occlude the iliac vessels and the lumbar arteries, as depicted in figures 4 and 5. A small vascular clamp should be applied to the inferior mesenteric artery. It is important to have the distal aorta freed sufficiently that this clamp can be placed far posteriorly to avoid interference with the arteriotomy and the anastomosis. A linear arteriotomy is made in the aorta to a point just above the inferior mesentery artery takeoff. Figure 5. An attempt is made to preserve that vessel. If at all possible, the graft is beveled. Figure 6a, and an end-to-side anastomosis is then created. Figures 6b, 7, 8, and 9, with a running OOO vascular suture, beginning at the inferior margin of the arteriotomy with a matrix suture, much as described in plate 153. The running suture then is carried up each side of the arteriotomy, and finally the anastomosis is completed in the middle of the arteriotomy on the operator's side. Many vascular surgeons prefer a direct end of aorta to end of graft anastomosis. In this technique, the aorta is dissected free circumferentially at the same level below the renal arteries and between lumbar vessels. Care must be taken to identify the caval and lumbar vessels during this dissection. A pair of vascular clamps are applied and the aorta is transected, leaving an adequate cuff for anastomosis proximally while oversewing the distal cuff with OOO vascular suture. A linear incision is made in the groin over the femoral artery, figure 10, and the common femoral, the profunda femoris, and the superficial femoral artery are carefully isolated. It is important to dissect at least several centimeters of the profunda femoris to evaluate the presence of disease in this vessel. If it is significantly involved, profunda end arterectomy or a profundoplasty should be considered, because this procedure appears to increase the longevity of graft function. A retroperitoneal tunnel is then made overlying the iliac artery and extending into the femoral incision, figure 10. By blunt finger dissection from above as well as from below the inguinal ligament, it is important to make this tunnel on the artery so that the ureter does not become entrapped. Care should be given to anterior displacement of the ureter so that after the procedure it will overlay the prosthetic graft. Finally, it is important to remember that all the dissections, aortic and femoral, and the tunnel should be completed before the patient is heparinized. The graft is pulled into the groin incision, figure 11, and the end beveled. Figure 12, vascular clamps have been placed on the common femoral, the profunda femoris, and the superficial femoral arteries, figure 13, and the linear arterotomy is made. It is not necessary to excise a button of artery wall. The anastomosis is carried out in the same manner as the upper end to side anastomosis of the graft to the aorta, figures 14 and 15. Just before completion of the femoral anastomosis, a clamp is placed on the opposite iliac limb of the graft and across the right common iliac beyond the bifurcation. The aortic clamp is opened momentarily to allow any potentially clotted material to be flushed out from the graft, figure 16. The clamp is replaced and the anastomosis is completed, then the aortic clamp is removed, with secure digital compression of the graft in order to ensure a gradually increased flow to the limb. Figure 17. The limb slowly is allowed to fill so that hypertension does not occur. Much as was outlined in the aortic aneurysm procedure, a similar procedure is followed in completing the anastomosis of the graft to the left common femoral artery. The incisions are closed in the routine manner. A running, 0 or 1, monofilament suture with large wide bites is used for the midline incision, whereas the groin incisions are closed in layers with absorbable sutures.